Welcome to Harlow on Healthcare. I'm David Harlow, and I invite you to join me by my virtual hearth as I sit down with healthcare leaders to discuss building the future of healthcare. Today, my guest is Lidia Fonseca. She is Senior Vice President and Chief Information Officer of Quest Diagnostics. Welcome, Lidia, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Happy to be here.
So how do you see the role of Chief Information Officer evolving as all of healthcare is evolving from being really an exclusively provider-centric focused industry to a more consumer-friendly focus?
Sure. So, you know, I think generally speaking, right, the role of the CIO has been evolving in the last couple of years as you think about this digital transformation that has been happening across various industries. And so, you know, the interesting thing about the role of a CIO is that, you know, not only do you have a vantage point because you work across the entire value chain of the business, but more and more, the interaction with customers, whether those are consumers or B2B situations like providers or hospitals or payers, those interactions are becoming more and more digital. And because they're becoming more digital, that means that our shift, there is a shift in terms of what we're responsible for and what we're expected to focus on. And what I mean by that specifically is it's no longer about systems and, you know, infrastructure. It really is about experiences and digital capabilities and digital differentiators and digital enablers. And so, you know, that's great because, you know, I really feel that this is a great time to be a CIO because we're getting a lot more involved in the customer and understanding their needs because a lot of the solutions and the customer's experience and their perception and their satisfaction with our companies are really coming back to those digital interactions. And so it's a great time, and I do think it's a lot more focused on the market, a lot more focused on customers. And just to give you a perspective, I spend 35-40% of my time with customers, precisely because for us to provide effective solutions, we gotta be able to understand not only what is needed, but also, you know, to hit the mark on the capabilities and the offerings that we're providing. So it's an exciting time.
It certainly is. That's great. It's great to hear that you're spending that much time with your customers as opposed to being a completely internally focused executive. There's so much talk about the experience, customer experience. Many companies today have a chief experience officer as well, and I'm interested to hear how you're folding that in within your brief as CIO.
Sure. So a couple of things. Quest, we do have a VP of customer experience, and so we work very closely with that VP of customer experience. The other thing that we have done at Quest is we actually created a center of excellence around design thinking. So I actually have a team of people that they focus on the design and the experience. And if you think about design thinking principles, it's all about creating solutions that are really built on empathy. And by empathy, meaning that you really have to understand, you know, what is the experience? What is it that that consumer of that service, of that interaction, you know, what is it that we're trying to solve, and how do we create, how do we save them time? How do we create an experience where they really get the most out of your company and out of our capabilities and our services? In our case, it's how do we give them information and how do we provide them services so that they can actually get to what they need as quickly as possible? And so we actually have a design team. And that's in my organization. And we learned, you know, we figured this out a couple years ago that we needed to have people that are experts in design and in experience. And so these folks are industrial engineers, industrial designers, digital experience, you know, experts. And they also take care of all the voice of the customer. Because the other thing we do when we develop solutions is that we actually bake into our sprints of development voice of the customer, focus groups, interviews. So we're really, and we will make adjustments, right, to our solution and to that experience based on what we're learning from the voice of the customer every step of the way. And that's, you know, part of what we do.
Well, that's very refreshing to hear. and certainly refreshing for your customers, I'm sure. So when you say customer, describe a customer. Who is your customer?
Great question, because you'll see that in our world, and you know, you're probably familiar with this, in our world, the people that consume our services, right, that patient or that consumer, is not necessarily the one who orders the service, because that's the provider a lot of the times, and it's not the one who pays for it, because that may be an employer, that may be an ACO, that may be an insurance company. And so when we think about our customers, it's really all of those audiences, right? It's the consumer, it's the provider, it's the care coordinator, it's the payer, it's the hospital administrators. So our customers are really, you know, a mix of audiences, and they each have a specific need. And so that's what makes our, at least my job, really, really interesting.
Yeah, it makes life interesting, certainly makes it very challenging as well.
You have to connect, right? You have to provide them a continuous kind of experience and service, because they, each of them have, you know, needs that are specific to who they are. And that makes it, you know, that makes our job actually very interesting, and we actually thrive on that.
That's great. So for those listeners who do not have a handy dandy cheat sheet at their fingertips explaining design thinking, could you give me a sort of 25 words or less, 60 seconds or less explanation
Sure.
of design thinking?
So design thinking is the idea that you design solutions, you know, and again, it's based on empathy. So you really empathize and understand. It's not just needs, it's emotional needs. So what is their feelings and their emotions, and especially in our world in healthcare, and you know, in some of our testing.
A lot of emotion.
Yeah, right? These are, sometimes you're diagnosed with something and all of a sudden you're going to need to have, you know, testing, and it's a, you know, it's an emotional time. So empathizing is a piece of it. Then another piece of it is that you actually iterate and you actually test your riskier ideas first. And the other one is that, you know, one of the things that's design thinking that we really like is that you actually refrain from judgment. And that's an important piece, because you gotta, you know, as technology folks, let's face it, some of us think we know all the answers. Well, we don't.
Shocking.
And so you, right? So you gotta kind of refrain from judgment and kind of say, all right, let that experience, let that emotional need drive what it is that we're trying to do. And then the other one is tolerate failure. That's the other concept of design thinking, that, you know what, not everything is going to work. And get the voice of the customer along the way, so that if it doesn't work, change it and do, you know, do the right thing that makes it work. And that's design thinking.
Great. So we're talking a bit about sort of the last mile, if you will, how you're reaching your various constituencies. But now I want to dig a little bit deeper and talk about some of the analytics under
Sure.
the hood. And there's a lot of talk about analytics in healthcare, and I understand that you're working on some real-time analytics solutions, and I'd
Sure.
like to understand a little bit more about those.
Sure. So let me frame that before I talk about specific, you know, offerings. One of the things that we did a couple of years ago is that we actually created a brand for all of our technology and data solutions, and that's our Quest Quantum brand. And as part of that brand, anything that we create as an offering, you know, we wanted to make sure that we could present it to our customers in a way that they could easily understand. So if you think about our Quest Quantum brand, you know, we have different, I talked about the different audiences that we serve. What we've learned is that analytics are actually required by all the different audiences, but the types of analytics that are required, it really depends on who they are.
Sure.
So if, you know, we've launched about 6 or 7 analytics offerings over the last couple of years. I'll touch on a couple of them, and for 2 different groups, one for providers, and then I'll talk about what we're doing for health systems and health plans, because they have certain specific needs, because they want to aggregate and they want to do benchmarking, which
Sure.
is a little bit different than what a provider who's, you know, looking at how do I provide better care to my patients,
Sure.
and I want to be focused on my patients as opposed to that aggregated view. So a couple of things that we do. So for example, for providers, we offer something that we call interactive insights as part of our Quantum. Quantum interactive insights enables them to be able to look at all of their patients and be able not to look at a patient and then look at them over time. Because, you know, it's easy to say, okay, they had a test, they had a diagnostic test. We can show you the result. We can give you even information about what the result means. We can give a little bit of context. But it makes a big difference for a provider if we can actually show you what's happening with that patient over time. And so the analytics for the provider are really, tell me as much as I need to know about the patient's condition and about those results, and what action should I take so that I know what's the next step in the treatment of that patient. Because I'm specifically looking at this one patient, and there's a care treatment that makes sense for them. So the analytics that we provide to providers are really geared towards how do we help them make the right decision and the next decision based on the outcomes, right, of the procedures, the testing that their patient has had. And do it in a longitudinal way, because that's going to really drive, you know, what they do. If you think about a health system, a hospital, let's say an integrated delivery network, and as you know, there's been a lot of consolidation, so they will have multiple sites. They may have hundreds or thousands of providers as part of their network. The analytics that they're looking for, it's more benchmarking. You know, how I want to drive certain disease programs, and I want to be able to, I want to make sure that my clinicians, my doctors, are following, you know, the protocols and
right.
the quality
You're talking
metrics.
About minimizing variation of practice.
Correct.
Yeah.
Variation of practice, but also, you know, if they've determined that there's certain quality metrics. So let's say, you know, there's certain measures that they want to be able to see, you know, how sure. they're doing across their system. They want to be able to look at how are we performing overall as a network, and then how do I benchmark the various providers so that I, again, with the idea that we're helping them to make the right decisions, whether they're clinical decisions, reimbursement decisions, or operational decisions in the case of a hospital. And then for a health plan, an insurance company, they're looking for, you know, analytics, for example. They want the providers to have, you know, the ability to use analytics. Again, if they have certain care guidelines, right, and coverage guidelines that they use to cover their members, and they want to be able to know, is this the right test for their patient at the right time? So the analytics from a health plan perspective are going to be, are, you know, can we tell that the members, their providers in their network are applying and behaving according to the guidelines that they've set? So, and so we have a number of different, and by the way, you're absolutely right. The analytics are both longitudinal and retrospective, as well as real time, because those decisions, that patient is in front of you, you want to be able to make a decision, and that means you need to be able to tap into those analytics at that moment. So we offer both. We offer the ability to do it real time, as well as looking historically, because that can also yield certain patterns as well.
If you're just tuning in, this is Harlow on Healthcare, coming to you live from HIMSS 2018 on Healthcare Now Radio. I'm David Harlow, and my guest today is Lidia Fonseca from Quest Diagnostics. Lidia, you talked about the information that's being pushed back out to the provider at the point of care. And my question, as you talk about how this can inform treatment decisions, where does that treatment pathway analytics knowledge base come from? So you have a test result in your hands, and you're delivering that back with a recommendation on treatment pathway. What's that based on?
Sure. So we as Quest, you know, number one, we have been in business for 50 years, so definitely a history of being in the diagnostic information services arena for a long time. We also have close to 700 MDs and PhDs in our company, and we are experts in laboratory medicine and in both general, routine, as well as advanced. So if you think about some of the genomics, genetics, oncology, you know, some of the more advanced, as well as a pretty wide menu of, you know, think about what we call routine cholesterol testing, pregnancy testing, infectious disease. So we really cover, we actually have one of the most comprehensive diagnostics test menus in the industry, right, as the kind of scale that we have. So when we, you know, so what we do is we actually, that, you know, we do have our doctors and our PhDs, because we see a third of the U.S. population every year, and, you know, 50% every 2 to 3 years, you know, we have the ability, because we're creating that content every day, to not only aggregate that information, and we do have 10 years worth of history in our big data platform. So we have the ability to mine that information, to mine those results, to mine all of these encounters that we have had. And just to give you an idea of the scale that we're talking about, we have 40 billion test results in our big data platform, right? And so what we do is we have our data scientists, we have our PhDs and our doctors mining that information, identifying patterns, identifying geography, geographical trends, identifying trends and conditions. And so we use that to create, these, what we call kind of national standards. And not only national, but we can also identify certain geographical trends as well, or even conditions, right? If you think about diabetes or hepatitis C. And so they're able to create a knowledge base that we have built over a long time. And so what we're doing is we take that knowledge base, we use our big data capabilities, and we do have some pretty snazzy, you can imagine, kind of data visualization capabilities, because our scientists can then use that, and then they create those kind of norms, they'll create, and then we put that back in the hands of community providers so they can really see how they're doing, because again, we have 170 million unique patient identities, and we're seeing so many people every year that we have this unique ability to actually show trends and patterns, and also we're setting standards along the way because of the expertise that we bring, and our customers really appreciate that. You can imagine, a doctor in the Midwest, as an example, I'm not specifically calling out somebody from the Midwest, but a doctor in the Midwest, now all of a sudden they have access to this phenomenal data set and this phenomenal, medical expertise, and we've codified it in a way that they can actually compare their patients against that national database, and it gives them some really important insights that help them in the treatment plans.
So let's walk through that a little bit. If I'm a primary care physician or I'm a specialist, and I've ordered a panel of tests for my patient, I get the results back through a Quest portal of one sort or another. And what is that? What comes along with the individual test result? What am I gaining by ordering this through you?
Sure. So let's take an example, and I'll give you an example of an oncology test, right? And let's say a physician orders an a set of oncology tests. And when they do that, what they're going to get back is they're going to get back not only the results of that oncology test, but for example, one of the offerings that we have integrated into our solution is a sophisticated report that we have done, as an example, together with Memorial Sloan Kettering and IBM Watson. So IBM Watson curates what research is available out there, and then with the experts at Memorial Sloan Kettering, because we created this together, we then generate a report. And that report, again, when I say report, it's both online as well as on paper. They can print it as well. And it'll actually show them, for example, in that case, some indications, not only the result, but also, again, certain patterns, or let's say they've identified, a certain tumor, and we actually are able to give them a lot more context behind the result, and that will include, again, a lot more context. So it's not just an individual result; it'll come with context that we've incorporated from our own expertise, as well as in that case, the partnership that we have with Memorial Sloan Kettering, and then leveraging on the research side. Let's say if there's a cool clinical trial that could be a good match, for this patient with this condition, we will actually incorporate that also into the result and into the information. So again, the idea behind this is that we're not just providing you with the result, we're providing also, information about what next step you should take. Oh, and by the way, here's a clinical trial that could be a good fit for your patient, doctor. And so we imagine packaging that all up, both on an online, view as well as a report view.
So you mentioned Sloan Kettering for cancer. You have partnerships with other specialty service organizations around the country delivering similar intelligence?
We do, you know, we do particularly in areas where we feel that that complements what we offer.
Sure.
And so, you know, the beauty about, you know, the offering, you know, that I mentioned, right, with the IBM Watson, our oncology, you know, offering, is that, again, our goal is to put resources in the hands of community providers. And so in that case, you know, you take a Memorial Sloan Kettering and you take, you know, the research capabilities of IBM Watson, and then you take our diagnostics capabilities, and that made a lot of sense for that, you know, for that particular offering. And then we do have other partnerships with other, you know, major partners, whether they're academic, you know, institutions. It could also be a partnership, let's say, with a, you know, with a payer where we want to drive certain, you know, certain medical quality metrics that are important. So yeah, we look for partnerships. We believe that healthcare is a team sport, and yeah, we definitely live that mission.
Great. So we talk about how this looks, what this looks like from a provider perspective. What does this look like from a patient perspective?
Sure.
Do I have the ability as a patient to log in, get a report of my individual test, and what sort of context do
sure.
I get around that?
Sure. So for patients, we do have a patient portal. That's MyQuest. And, you know, we have 5 million patients that interact with us. And patients can access the results. They can make appointments 24/7. They can pay bills online. We also have other capabilities, like what we've learned is that 30% of consumers are actually a caregiver. That means they're actually caring for a dependent child or a dependent parent. And so we also provide them with the ability to not only manage their own health, but also integrate, you know, a dependent child or dependent parent's information.
With a single login.
Yes, with a single login, a MyQuest account.
Right.
And so what they're going to see is, again, they have the similar kind of longitudinal views. They'll have the report available. The other thing that we've done, again, to facilitate that communication is that in the provider's view, we actually incorporate that patient view as well. So the patient has the ability, so they're both will be seeing a similar, you know, the information. But then the context that we provide for a patient, again, right, it has to be patient-friendly. And so there's more educational context, videos. You know, we've incorporated additional content that's going to help them, because they're not going to, you know, a clinician has a certain level of expertise and knowledge. So we've made it so that there's a lot more context that's really consumer-friendly.
Right. Is there more that would be available for, quote-unquote, the expert patient or someone with a chronic condition who... You know, as we all know, sometimes the patient with a chronic condition has more clinical knowledge than even a specialist, because they're living with a particular condition over time.
Yes, and there are. I mean, for patients that have, you know, a chronic condition, there is more, because the way our solution and our context is, you actually can drill in how deep you want to go. So, right, so we have content available, and what we find, because we can actually see what people do on our MyQuest portal, is we can actually see how deep, I almost call it like, you know, I'm peeling the layers of an onion.
Yes.
And we can see, you know, and actually, we can definitely see when we have a chronically ill patient that they definitely will go deeper into those layers of content and context. And we do have other resources that we include as they go deeper. But you're right. And so we make a solution flexible. Clearly, the content is there. It's a matter of how they navigate and, you know, how deep they go into the different levels.
Great. So let me ask you this. If you were to wake up tomorrow and find yourself 5 years in the future, what is one thing in healthcare that you would hope or expect to find has changed dramatically?
One thing, huh? You're going to limit me to one thing.
I'll start with one.
Well, you know, there's a couple of things that I definitely, in 5 years, I would expect that driverless cars have moved forward further. I think we're getting closer, right? I think I think in 5 years, you know, we've been, all of us now are attached, I call it the iPhone prayer, or if you have an Android, your Android prayer, where, you know, we have this on-demand kind of behavior. It wasn't that long ago, or the, you know, on the planes, or these to make you shut down your your mobile device. And, you know, nowadays, Wi-Fi is available and people are consuming.
Right, we're always connected.
It's on demand, we're always connected. I do think in 5 years, though, the interaction is going to be more voice activated as opposed to a more tactile where we're, you know, typing in things. And I do think that that's going to be an interesting, because it's again going to create a different kind of an interaction because language, you know, language expresses itself a little bit different. So I do see more voice activated, leveraging more of those chatbots, those intelligent assistants. I think we can definitely see more of that. I'm seeing the, you know, the little seedlings of that, you know, coming into play. We're certainly leveraging some of those chatbots today for a couple of kind of simple use cases, but yes. I can see that very quickly, you know, moving to more, you
right.
know.
It could ratchet up as these tools become more intelligent, and then of course we need to provide a compliant back end from a HIPAA
yes.
perspective and otherwise
correct.
For those tools, which isn't there yet.
And then the third thing that I would say is I think that I can definitely see that by that point, I think I believe that blockchain has, you know, definitely has the promise to do something that we've always wanted to do in healthcare, which is make it easier for us to access certain information that all of us are always accessing all the time, and each of us individually in the ecosystem have had to invest. And so I do see in 5 years that blockchain has proven out that we can simplify and improve information exchange, so data exchange. So that's three of the ideas. I have more, but I certainly, you know, and maybe it's a little hopeful, you know, wishful thinking, but those are the three that I kind of feel in 5 years, I think are going to be pretty prevalent.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You have been listening to Harlow on Healthcare. Join us at healthcarenowradio.com. Let's continue the conversation on building the future of healthcare together at #HarlowOnHC. I'm David Harlow, keeping the fire going and holding a seat open for you. Until next time.